I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I made you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. Your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know.
Your soul, what matters come to mind. The cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not all wasted time. Seeking you will find. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. The years roll by. We wonder why we lost our way from home. Our father finds the child inside. We left for growing old.
Good morning, Coast Hills family and friends. My name is Julia. I'm the Director of Ministries for Youth and Worship here at Coast Hills Community Church, where we are a Jesus-centered community creating gracious space through acts of generous love. I hope you've all enjoyed that 1 hour of extra sleep that you got last night. What a blessing! Hallelujah. We are grateful. Amen. Okay, so today is the first of the month, which means two things. First off, it is Communion Sunday, so Kevin will be leading us in communion at the end of the service. Please ensure that you have a bread and a cup to drink with as we participate online together. Secondly, on the first of the month, we have what's called a Community Care Fund. So it's a special offering that goes towards supporting the needs in our grander community. And so what you can do is you can donate online. You'll be able to go to coasthillschurch.com and find a link. And that will go towards supporting needs within our own community at Coast Hills, as well as the community at large. And so thank you for those who have given already that are able to give. We are so grateful. Friends, would you join me in prayer as we continue in this service? Lord, we are grateful for this day, for this opportunity to meet online together as a Coast Hills family. May we be attentive to what you would have to say to us today, both individually and as a community. Lord, let us be aware of your presence, of your voice, and let us respond with lives of worship, ones that bring glory to you, God, ones that cause curiosity in those around us. Lord, may we live lives that are true to who you are. May we live lives within our own community here at Coast Hills that creates a Jesus-centered community with gracious space and acts of generous love. We are grateful, Lord, for the opportunity to gather and to praise your name together online. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing, friends.
risen, he's alive. Welcome here. Great to have you back at Coast Hills Community Church, where we are a Jesus-centered community creating gracious space through acts of generous love. We're in the middle of our series called Stories of Grace. Today, the title of my sermon is Grace That Is Unconditional. We're going to be looking at the story that involves one of Jesus' disciples, or another word for that would be his followers, and that person would be the person of Judas. We're going to look at a very sad story of his death in Matthew 27, verses 1 to 10. And then we're going to go back in time slightly to Matthew 26, chapter 26, verses 19 to 30, which looks at the Last Supper. And we're going to try and see what we're able to glean from this ancient text. This ancient text that actually has the power and the authority and the inspiration to speak into our lives and our hearts today. So let's get at it. Early in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people made their plans how to have Jesus executed. So they bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas had betrayed him, he saw that Jesus was condemned. He was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. When he went away, and he hanged himself. The chief priests picked up the coins and said, "It is against the law to put this into the treasury, since it is blood money." So they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why it has been called the field of blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. It says, "They took the 30 pieces of silver, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field, as the Lord commanded." Okay, so this is kind of a sad story. We have Judas Iscariot, who is one of Jesus' disciples, killing himself. Where is the unconditional in that story, Kevin? I can hear most of you saying. So stick with me. I hope that we're able to see it very soon. Judas was among the 12 men that were chosen to be with Jesus. So Jesus and Judas was trusted with the duty of stewarding all the finances of the Jesus movement during that time. And for 3 years, he enjoyed special relationships, special favor, fellowship with Jesus. So we need to understand that Judas was with Jesus for 3 years, the same as Simon and John and Peter, Nathaniel, and all the rest. He was hanging out with Jesus, weddings and funerals, banquets, seeing him perform miracles, and living out really what it looked like to what Jesus would call the kingdom of God here on earth. So Judas was in the inner circle. And I just want to say, as we look at this story right from the get-go, that it's very sobering to think that proximity and access to Jesus will not automatically exclude you from rough times and desperate thoughts. I want to say that again here. Proximity and access to Jesus would not automatically exclude you from rough times and desperate thoughts. In the verses earlier, Judas had betrayed Jesus with a kiss, the sign that was given to the chief priests so that they could recognize who Jesus was in the dark of the night. Jesus then gets arrested, and then Judas sees this arrest and then sees that he is to be condemned to die. So then Judas, what does he do? He runs to the people that he made this terrible, evil deal with, the chief priests and the elders of Israel. He runs to where they are, and they're in the temple, and he says to them, I could just imagine, he says to them, I've sinned, for I've betrayed innocent blood. And their response to him was one of dismissiveness and not recognizing his thoughts, his feelings. In the midst of this, I also have to ask the question, why did Judas betray Jesus? I don't think we can really get at a good answer for it. But we do have to wonder, maybe a further insight into Judas would be, why did he only show remorse when Jesus was condemned to death? Did he think that maybe if he engineered a confrontation between Jesus and Caiaphas, Jesus would give Caiaphas such a devastating answer that everyone would be convinced that Jesus is the Messiah? Or did Judas think that and hope that Jesus would flex his military Messiah muscles, then decide it was time to summon up the 12 legions of angels that he would be able to call on if needed? Did Judas think that somehow turning Jesus over would force Jesus to actually get on with bringing in the kingdom of God here on earth like they were thinking it would look like and be a real leader? We don't know. We cannot be sure of Judas's motives. But what we do see in this story is that something inside Judas realizes what he had done and that it was terribly wrong. And he felt, the scripture says, he felt a deep remorse. Matthew tells us that there was a great sense of this regret that overcame him. And he was now able to see what he had done was wrong. Then Judas, like I said, runs to the leaders of a religious institution who also happened to be the ones that he made the deal with. What kind of response was it? Verse 4, it tells us, and they said, what is that to us? That's your responsibility. They tell Judas, basically, you're on your own, pal. He met them with indifference. Judas, at a time of deep desperation and spiritual distress, meets indifference and also dismissiveness in saying, we don't care. You see, there's no feeling toward him right now. His ties to the religious leaders at the time were merely transactional. I don't know about you, but I think it's a difficult thing in life to discover that relationships that you thought were maybe mutual and maybe there was some interest and concern for each other were simply transactional. Judas discovers that this relationship he was in with these leaders was less about him and more about him doing what they wanted him to do. When we experience this kind of relationship, that it's only transactional, we find out that the other party is in it not for relationship, but only for what they can get out of it or what they can get us to do. And that causes deep, deep pain. And in this story, we're now seeing the true colors of the religious leaders They were in it for what they could get out of it, and they wanted their way. Scholar N.T. Wright says this, "Perhaps the most interesting thing about this story that we just read is the people who do not show remorse." Judas is feeling this remorse. He understands this. And he runs to the leaders who are in the temple. Judas came into the temple complaining bitterly of guilt, pleading for some kind of help. And no help was given. In this story, we should not miss the irony of what's happening here. This isn't about only Judas wishing that he'd never been born and the priest just being aloof. The other part of the story, what's happening here, is that this is the beginning of the end of the temple system, a system that in the end actually leads to death and leaves a desperate person all alone. The temple authorities themselves can't even help a man who complains of guilt and impurity. The chief priest here has refused to listen to the Messiah's warnings that Jesus was saying for years now, and Jesus' challenges. And so the whole system now that he's representing is starting to crumble. The story is pointing to the fact that the temple system that had been propped up by these leaders is now showing its true colors, that it's a transactional system of what they can get from people instead of what they're able to do for people or even be with people. Judas is longing for some kind of mercy or grace here for what he's done. He runs to the temple where the God of Israel was believed to reside. And the priests, who were God's go-between, the people and God, were there. And he finds no help for his shame, no help for his guilt, no help for his remorse. And ultimately, he succumbs to the weight of that guilt in his life when he finds no hope. Let's just pause there for a moment. It's kind of heavy stuff. But I want to take us a few verses prior and look at the posture of Jesus towards Judas, the now betrayer. Matthew 26:19-30 says this. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." They were very sad, began to say to him one after the other, "Surely you don't mean me, Lord." And Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as is written about him. But woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until the day I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And then he was betrayed. Here in this story, we have Jesus with the 12 disciples gathered together, and he serves them all this first communion. They would have understood it to be the Passover meal, being thankful to the God of Israel that would have saved the people of Israel from the clutches of Egypt. And this is a story shouting about the thankfulness that they were pulled out of slavery from Egypt. And here Jesus is using it to pronounce something new that's happening. not just for Israel, but for all mankind. The Gospel of John starts this story off by saying this. Jesus was about to show them the full extent of his love. And Jesus knows what Judas is about to do. Knowing what Judas is about to do doesn't change Jesus' posture towards Judas. I find that absolutely stunning. Does Jesus still speak the truth to him? Yes, you see it. He doesn't pretend that things are going to just work out just right. He says, one of you is going to betray me. And I wonder what the other disciples were looking around at that moment. They're all asking the same questions. Who could it be? Would it be me? All the disciples were asking, surely you don't mean me, Lord. And Matthew repeats the question again, and has it come from Judas himself? You don't mean me, Lord. We know that in different ways, each of the disciples either denied Jesus, distanced themselves from Jesus, once they saw that he was on this pathway to self-sacrificial death that the Romans were going to exert on him. Jesus, knowing that these disciples were going to deny him, run from him, and actually Judas betray him, Jesus continues to be consistent to who he is and extends his unconditional grace to all, everyone at that table, even Judas, by offering them the life and healing that will ultimately come from the death of himself. And in the end, we see Judas looking for forgiveness in the wrong place and from the wrong people, even though the grace of Jesus was still available to him. And I don't think that changed. What changed was Judas's response. So what does this mean for us? Like Judas and the disciples, we ask this question. It isn't me, is it, Master? N.T. Wright says this, only when you've said that question, isn't it me, Master, knowing that it might well be you, can you begin to appreciate what it meant for Jesus to sit at the table and to share that Passover meal with this group of men. And what Jesus is going to do, what Jesus does for us in sharing communion with us, in which we're going to participate in later. What does it mean that he has promised to share his feast with us as well? When we say that Jesus died because of our sins, we don't just mean that in some high-flown, kind of abstract, ethereal sense. We mean that what we put on the cross was precisely the sins that we all not only commit, but I would say that sometimes we just wallow in, like we see Judas stirring in as well. And now we know that Jesus, in the end, was the one that took all of that shame, all of that guilt, all of that regret, all of that remorse, all of that sin to the cross on our behalf. What beautiful good news. What a beautiful good news that this grace from Jesus is unconditional. There's nothing we can do to gain favor, in a sense. But Jesus always is extending that kind of unconditional grace to everyone at the table, no matter that he knows, in a sense, what you might be doing or what you might end up doing. So the question is, what do we do with this now as Jesus followers? Or maybe you're watching online. Maybe you're just exploring this. I want us to look at four observations for us. One, the truth about who we are. We as humans need social engagement with others that will comfort us and care for us in our distress. Getting pushed aside in a moment of desperation, we see here, ultimately leads to death. And so this is why we want to be a Jesus-centered community. We want to create gracious space and safe place for people to be able to say, this is what's happening in my life. Second, the truth about who God is. We can be at our worst and still be unconditionally loved by God. When we bring our guilt, our remorse, our shame, our internal conflict, whatever it would be, to Jesus, Jesus doesn't say, what is that to me? He's not dismissive to us. No, he reveals his love, his unconditional grace, and his forgiveness to us. It's actually revealed on the cross for all of us. And Jesus remains present with us and invites us to the table of this unconditional grace that he has set. That's the truth about God. Thirdly, the truth about what we need to do. I think, pretty sure, we need to validate people's experiences of pain to remind them that they're not alone. We need to validate people's experiences of pain to remind them that they're not alone. This story is highlighting the fact that we need flesh and blood people to embody the truth of this. When we encounter someone that comes to us in their pain and disillusionment, may we have the compassion to be present with them. We might not have all the answers to their questions, but we can validate who they are and the experiences that they're having. Fourth observation is this: the truth about what God has done. God reveals his ultimate act of unconditional grace through the death of Jesus. God's posture to us is one of love and compassion, and one that wants to be engaged in who we are. And on the cross, we have the full extent of his love shown to all, and even his enemies. In a few weeks, we're going to talk about what does this grace look like when he's on the cross and there's two thieves beside him. What did they do to be able to earn that? Well, spoiler alert, nothing. It's what Jesus has done in and for them. And are we willing to receive that? Once a month, as a church, we participate in communion together. Over thousands of years, the church has celebrated this sacred symbol together, being reminded that Jesus does in fact offer his unconditional grace to those people who are willing to sit at the table of grace. We're going to do that today. I will simply use the same scripture that we looked at in Matthew 26, that we looked at today, to lead us through this. As we participate in this act of communion, that we want to also acknowledge that we're coming to Jesus for this unconditional grace that we need so desperately. Know that his posture is one of giving of himself, not just taking what he wants. God's posture to us is one of giving us life, not bringing us death. I want to invite you to participate in this communion. It's still a COVID communion, although we have live people here that are going to be taking communion together, which is a beautiful thing. But if you're at home, you can grab wine or juice or any kind of liquid and cracker or bread, and you can participate in this with us. It's the liturgy we use as an invitation to the table. This is the table, not of the church, but of God. It is to be made ready for those who love God and who want to love God more. So come. You who have much faith and you who have little. You who have been here often and you who have not been here for a long time. You who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come not because I invite you. It's God. And it is God's will that you who want God should meet God here. So, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat this, my body." Take and eat. Jesus, as we eat this bread, let it be a sign of all that you did for us and all who you are. Then he took a cup. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink." Jesus, thank you for this cup. And as we drank it, may we be reminded of all that you have done for us. And be reminded of all who you are. Jesus, thank you for this reminder today in a hard story, but knowing full well that you continue to offer unconditional grace to all. God, I pray that for those of us that are able to, I pray that we would be people that would be ones that would be extending the same grace to other people, ones that would maybe even simply validate someone else's pain so that they would know that they're not alone. Jesus, we thank you also for the love that you've shown in and through the cross and your work on the cross. And the forgiveness of sin that you've offered all of us. God, we're so thankful for that. We're thankful that we don't receive this because of anything that we've done or any merits that we have, but simply because of your love for us. Remind us of that love, God, in our own lives. May we be reminded of your posture towards us so that in those times that we might have of desperation, of guilt and regret, that we might be able to run to you, the God who would actually validate and sit with and be with us in the midst of that, and offer forgiveness. God, would you bring people along our paths that we know that we aren't alone? Continue to point us towards the hope that you have for us, lived out in real life, flesh and blood people. Thank you for your scripture. Thank you for this time. God, we're just thankful for your unconditional grace. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful
into your week, knowing that you are loved perfectly, that you're covered in God's unconditional grace, and you're empowered as a follower of Jesus to share God's love and His grace with everyone you meet this week. Peace.